Welcome to the Black Entrepreneur Experience Podcast, inside the business, buzz, and brilliance of Black entrepreneurs. Here is your host, Dr. Frances Richards.
What happens in Vegas goes all over the world on Black Entrepreneur Experience, episode 110. Thank you for joining us as we elevate the Black entrepreneur experience by interviewing CEOs, thought leaders, innovative thinkers, and Black entrepreneurs across the globe. I'm your host, Dr. Frances Richards. You know, few people have been invited to the White House to represent the president's staff, to present to the president's staff, testify to Congress. What about graduated from the FBI Citizen Academy, worked at the United Nations, started four companies, and sold one, a global speaker with hands-on experience in marketing, sales, personal branding, technology? And our guest loves burnt pancakes, bacon, eggs, two cold glasses of water, and syrup, pancake and syrup on the weekend. Best-selling author, Ramon Ray.
Hey, doctor. Thanks for having me. So excited to be here and share with our community and our audience. So thank you. And I do like those pancakes burnt and bacon. So thank you.
I know. You know, my mom loves burnt food also. So, yeah, go figure. You have such an impressive bio, and I have given our audience just a tad bit. Why don't you fill in the gaps, what you'd like them to know about you and your companies?
Sure. I mean, listen, I'm just so honored to be here, and anything I can do to share knowledge with others, I've been helped so much in my career, and I'd like to think that I have a lot more to go. But I know also there's people who are, you know, upcoming and going to go through some things that I've gone through already. If I can share that with our audience, it's always good to do so. But in a nutshell, I work with large brands and I help them better communicate and represent themselves to smaller businesses. So what that means, I'm often hired to speak, host events, speak at events, produce events, et cetera. Another part of the business that we have is featured content. So brands are looking to get the word out about their products, about their services. They launch something new. The executive has some thought leadership through our channel, smarthustle.com, one of my companies, or Smart Hustle Magazine, and also smallbiztechnology.com. We feature content from our partners to our community. And of course, all around that, providing great insight and information to our small business community. But in a nutshell, brand representation through myself, like influencer marketing, people call it, and also then content marketing. Those are the two broad things that we do.
Ramon, you definitely hit a buzz button there with that influencer marketer. Everyone wants that to be an Instagram sensation. How did you get into that field?
By accident, and as my clients say, I think by being easy to work with. And I think that there's, for this discussion, I'll separate the different types of, as it were, influencer marketers. There's some, I hate to use the proverbial Kim Kardashian, but she's the most famous one out there. Other big stars, there's so many out there, hundreds and thousands out there. They have these huge, massive, hundreds of thousands to millions of followers on Instagram, Facebook, or Twitter, or YouTube. And brands reach out to them and say, hey, listen, if you'll talk about our phone, talk about our new water bottle, talk about our new shoe, we will pay you. And the fees range. We can get into that, but the fee is not so important. We'll pay you somehow, some way, to share that with your audience. That's one type of the traditional influencer. Hey, look at me. I'm on a beach. I got a free hotel. That's not what I do, per se. As an entrepreneur, as you know, we've talked a bit, one who started companies and sold a company, and I would like to think I'm blessed to have a body of credible work. There's brands that say, you know, listen, we'd like to work with Ramon about our new phone service. We'd like to work with Ramon about our new marketing campaign we're going to launch. How can we align with him and his brand to communicate that to his community and to represent us to our community? So if that makes sense, kind of, that's what I do. Not necessarily, hey, I got a new pair of these, you know, sneakers. Look, I'm wearing them. You should too. Not so much of that. It's more so, I like this particular type of phone. I use it in my company. Here's why you may like it too. And I'm doing events with them, webinars and Twitter chats. Does that kind of help and make sense, or did I kind of make that confusing?
Absolutely, that makes sense. What was that aha moment that you knew that your business was going to be successful?
Yeah, for me, it's grown and taken a lot of evolutionary bounds. So I don't know if there's one moment, but I can say I know a few distinct journeys is when I left the UN and, in fact, kind of ish got fired. I say that because I knew it was coming and I didn't do anything wrong. I had, well, the wrong thing I'd done, I guess. I had my own business. business, and the UN has some rules against having your own business. But I had permission. The permission was revoked, and so I was kind of in a quandary. But the bottom line is, I was let go, and I didn't have a lot of notice. And so right then I knew I had to, you know, make it work. And so my business has come, that's why I have several multiple revenue streams. I have my event business that I started at the UN when I let go, so I had to just ramp it up. And I think really the aha moment, I guess, came for me, Dr. Richards, is I guess when you just see the brands liked what I was doing. When you see these big, big brands, I can mention some names, you know, think of PayPal, AT&T, Microsoft, Dell, billion-dollar brands. I've been humbled to have them say, you know what, Ramon? We want to work with you. We want to fly you to our conference. We would like to pay you, Ramon, to do a series of 10 webinars with us. So after seeing that come, that's kind of where I never rest. I never get, you know, I'm all there. But that's when I said, you know, there's a market for people who can communicate well, who can integrate a brand, who have an audience, who have a community. Brands want to work with you. So I may not be as big as some person on Shark Tank or some famous celebrity on TV show who has a new hair product. But you know what? I have my little community and brands like what I'm doing. And I'm blessed to say that I am able to take care of my family and give to others from what I'm blessed to receive.
Ramon, when you say your fan base, your community, and someone is listening and they're saying, I want to be an influencer, I want to get paid, I want to be a brand ambassador, mm-hmm. is there a number of fans or tribes that you need in order to go after brands, or does it depend on the market?
Sure. So I think it depends. And if we want to narrow it down a bit, if you want to throw out a random market, we can, you know, it could be anything. Make it difficult, easy, but I don't want to be biased to my own market. Anything we should maybe make a case or make a we'll pretend business? Anything you want to throw out there?
Yeah, let's say like makeup.
Okay,
like lipstick.
Love it. So, and let's assume the community is female, let's assume. So we're going to talk to Jane, and Jane saying, Ramon, maybe I'm in the cosmetic industry. I like lipstick, like to glam myself up, and I want to work with more companies in that space. Fair enough?
Fair.
Okay, got it. So here's where I would start to, I forgot her name, but Jane, let's say to Jane. One, Jane, do you pop, do you sizzle, are you dynamic? And this is my journey now. So that's one question Jane can ask herself. Are you magnetic? That's one. Assuming Jane says yes to that answer, then two, what can you share with your audience and who are they? Are they stay-at-home moms? Are they college teens? Are they young working professionals? Are they seniors? I don't know. Female's not enough to define it. So narrow down, who is that and what are you sharing to them? If you look on my Twitter, Dr. Richards, and Facebook, and you can Google me, you'll see it hones towards entrepreneurial, starting a business, growing a business. I do it in a fun way. So our test person here, you know, our new influencer, she has to determine who's the audience, what she's going to say. Once she does that, breathe, take your time. It's going to take time to start building that community, whether it's on Facebook, whether it's on Twitter, whether it's via email newsletter, but you have to have the tools to enable your community to rally around you and to chat about all things lipstick or glam or whatever you want. Once you do that, one of two things is going to happen, and both could happen. It happens to me all day long. A, companies are going to find you. You're going to get an email through your webpage. If you look, I have my webpage, RamonRay.com. It happens to me all the time. I quote, hey, Ramon, we see you like burnt pancakes and bacon. We love your videos and everything you're doing. Could you come, this billion-dollar company, and host our event? So that's where somebody came to me. Or an option would be, you go find a company. I'm making it up, L'Oreal. Again, I don't know much about lipstick and makeup, but you go to a company like that and you find their marketer, you find their influencer, head of influencer marketing. Say, listen, my name is Jane. I got several thousand people on Twitter, highly engaged community. We have an event maybe annually called, you know, Ladies Who Glam or something. Would you like to be a part of it? So I'll stop there. I feel sometimes I'm talking too long, but that's at a 2 minute, 3 minute rant, kind of what my quick guidance, and I'm sure I'm leaving some things out, what I would say to somebody listening to is a quick way with how the roadmap could be.
Now, at this point, when you are going to the brands and mm-hmm. saying, hey, I'm Jane and I have my community, is it a situation where should I have a figure in mind, like a dollar amount, or is that negotiable? How is that going to work?
Yeah, and that, I guess, you know, there's really, unfortunately, no science to it. There is just, you can have one guy, you know, who has 10,000 followers on Twitter and who gets paid $1,000 for a speech. Another guy who has 10,000 followers on Twitter and gets paid $10,000. I found, Dr. Richards, it all goes back to, as Steve Harvey kind of says, your swag, how you represent yourself, how you talk, the energy you convey, who you've talked to, what they need and what you can deliver, because it's not always a dollar for dollar. Now, in the game of influencer marketing like Instagrammers, you know, oh, I got 2,000 followers, send me a free lipstick. That's transactional. Our rates are this. For every 500 followers, we give you a dollar. But I don't play in that game. I'm in a whole other game of, it's not really a game of, who is my client? What do they need? How can I best make them look good through a variety of options they can pick from, if that makes sense. I'm not looking at it as a reach 27 of my followers. I'm looking at it, I'm Ramon Ray. You want to look good and sound good. I can help that happen to you. What is it worth it to you? Which is a different game.
What is a problem, Ramon, that exists in the world today that you'd like to solve?
That's a big question, and I love the question. I think that a few things I'm very passionate about. One, though, is, and I actively seek this as mentorship. I think that I can speak on business, but if I had to speak personally, there's a lot of young people growing up who do not have guidance. I don't know your background, you know, Dr. Richards, but my background, for example, I would assume you're a smart, you know, woman. I bet growing up there was somebody you wish you could talk to, hand to hold, shoulder to cry on. Maybe at some point in your life, I happen to grow up with a two-parent family. But there's a lot of young people who need coaching, who need a helping hand, who need someone else to speak to. Even if they have two-parent family or one-parent family, a mother who loves them, a dad who loves them, they still need somebody. So I guess the problem I'd like to solve is loneliness, is depression, is young people not having guidance. That's the problem I'd like to solve.
Who is that person that you cry on their shoulders, or they're taking your hand and lifting you up?
Sure. I must say I've had probably a lot of people in my life. And I'll use, one of them, his name is Yakov Yurinsky. Kind of has a funny sounding last name to many people. Not a funny sounding last name to him, but, you know, Yurinsky, like, well, what kind of name is that? But point being is that I've known Yakov for maybe 20 years, let's say. I'm making, it could be 15. And he's been someone, another entrepreneur who's gone beyond me and built businesses and sold them of more dollar value and a little more maturity in business than I am. I've relied on him for years. Another one I can fondly speak of is Mr. Chidam Badanathan. He carried me a lot through my years at the UN when it got very difficult. And I can rely on my friends who I have around me now. Jacob comes to mind. Ashish comes to mind. So I have a small network of friends I rely on. My wife as well. And I'm a man of prayer too. So I have a good team.
Absolutely. Someone is listening, Ramon, and they're saying, wow, I like what Ramon is saying. I do need a mentor. How do you vet those people to get a mentor in your life?
Yeah, and to be clear, how would I vet someone who I want to, like the mentee mentor, or how would someone who wants mentorship know if the mentor is right for them, just to be clear on that?
The latter.
Okay, and I forgot what I said.
That's okay. Someone is saying, gosh, I want to start a business or I'm in business and I need a mentor.
Okay.
How do I find that person that's good for me?
Sure, absolutely. A few things I would say. One, a big shout out to SCORE, Service Corps Retired Executives, SCORE.org. Great organization where you can just go in for free and get counseling and other nonprofits like that if you don't know anybody. But here's what I would say, and be very careful that you're working with a mentor who has your best interest in mind. Now, this doesn't mean somebody wants something at some point and you mutually help each other. That's business. That's great. People can mutually help each other. But let's say Dr. Richards says, Ramon, listen, I'm starting a fitness studio. Can you help me? Dr. Richards needs to make sure Ramon's not competing against you. I'm not asking you to go into debt because I want to buy your business. You know what I mean? There's some grimy people. So I think, A, if the person listens to you, 2, do they follow up? 3, do you have a history with them? 4, do they push you? 5, are they acting altruistic and they have never asked something from you? That, I think, is a few ways to do that. And noting, it doesn't mean that someone, doesn't have something, maybe you can help them in some way, but you want to make sure, do I have a mentor or do I have a business partner or do I have a client or do I have a competitor? You want to be very clear. A mentor is someone who just wants you to succeed.
Talk to a younger Ramon. What advice would you give to a younger Ramon?
Wow. You know, I would say in a heartbeat to a younger Ramon, listen, Ramon, one, understand numbers better, your finances. That's probably the biggest thing I would say, understand your numbers better and be a bit more methodical and think slower before you take action. That's probably the two biggest things I would say. I made a lot of mistakes, a lot of screw-ups because I didn't take time to think. So I'd probably tell Ramon, slow down. Think more. And Ramon, go to a night school, to college or something, and learn numbers, profit and loss, balance sheets, things like this, because I have to kind of learn as I'm going and just refresh myself of what's going on. So that's what I would say.
And you talked about the risk or those moments that was a little challenging in business. Mm. Talk about that. What was that worst moment in business for Ramon, and what was your takeaway?
Yeah, I mean, I think I've had a lot of, maybe there's not one worst moment, but I think a few things. I think one is that doing events is a very expensive proposition. The events I do, I'm not talking about million-dollar events like the Super Bowl, nor am I talking about where you get some stale pizza, around people with 10 tables. But events in a space and venue can cost $50,000, $60,000, $75,000. I'm going to confess something to you just between you and me. I'm just teasing. That I've done events. Sponsor didn't come through. I went too fast. You can kind of hear I'm hearkening back to your earlier question, Vice Ramon, and lost money. So I think that my advice, and that's kind of the low points I've had when I've done big deals that have fallen through or I didn't think through. That's one. I didn't think thoroughly is the word. And I think point two is probably when I left the UN. I must say leaving the UN was the biggest blessing because I wouldn't have the freedom or be what I'm doing today if I hadn't left. But it was scary. It was scary having a family, smaller kids at the time. You got to make that happen. So that was pretty scary.
We can learn from successful entrepreneurs, peoples, or brands. Tell us a brand or a business that you think is dominating or you admire and why.
Yeah, I think what I'll do is probably maybe I'll go two ways. I'll talk about a bigger brand or a smaller brand. I think, listen, hats off to Amazon. They're the biggest brand out there. But why do I say hats off to them? Because as you may know, most people would agree, they provide stellar customer service.
Yes.
From the beginning, by the time out of your mouth comes out, my coat didn't reach. Before you even say, the ACH and reach, no problem. We'll send you a new one today.
Right.
So you got to hand it to them. So Amazon, from a big company perspective, and listen, I have so many friends around me who are rocking their businesses. I can think of Rachel, Empire Tax Professionals. Listen, small little company, but she is rocking in her training and customer service, and I can go on. But from big, big, big brands, I don't want to mention too many, in case of my clients, Ramon, why did you mention them and not us? But I'd probably have to hand it to Amazon. They rock in their customer service.
Yeah, they really do. And it's that whole adage that they say, under promise, over deliver, and they do. And I've read a lot about Jeff Bezos and just where he started and him being such a visionary. And I'm always, he's a disruptor, but in a very positive way in the markets. And his sights is very precise on what he's wanting to do is take over the planet. And he's doing a fine job, right?
Absolutely. As of today.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. It could change because we see, not that we're wanting a demise of anyone, but we're seeing a slow decline in Facebook. They were up top, but we're just talking about what's happening today. So I agree. As my Amazon package came an hour ago.
See, good for you.
What's a daily or a weekly habit that you do consistently that has given you the greatest success, Ramon?
Sure. Maybe if you don't mind, I'll just talk about some of the habits I do and you can help me figure out. You can do some coaching to me on this interview. But I have a habit of drinking water. It sounds weird, but I guess for me it's important because I've been a soda drinker for a long part of my life. So I drink a lot of water. Every morning, I drink a cup of water. I read my Bible every morning. I do 20 to 50 push-ups, give or take, throughout the day, but also first thing in the morning and stretch. So that's kind of a habit, my spiritual and mental fitness and my body, that I'm not some super ripped guy, no. But as I get older, I'd like to think, if I can take the stairs when I can, drink water, stretch my body to be limber, I guess, I don't know, and do some push-ups, I think I'll be okay, notwithstanding things that happen to your body. You can't help but get hit by a bus. So that's pretty much some daily habits. I think the word is fastidious. I like big words. I don't know half what they mean, but I'm pretty fastidious about email. So everybody has a different way they communicate, but email is a habit that I've honed to a science. My inbox has usually a zero inbox policy every day. So those are a few things that I do that happen. Most success, maybe, if you don't mind, I'll ask you, you're the interviewer, but maybe you could help me guide into most success. I'm not sure, but those are a few habits.
That is excellent. Thank you so much. And we have very similar. I'm up at 4 okay. every morning, and I'm at the gym by 5. Mm-hmm. And I do my Bible study, and I do my affirmations, and I have 30 minutes of that. And so, and the water, I actually track the water that I drink
wow.
all day. So I endeavor to drink 6 to 7 16-ounce of water per day.
Wow.
So yeah, I'm an avid water drinker. And it's really interesting you mentioned about the soda, because I was reading something. I posted something on Facebook about just water. They were talking about, I think, sodas, drinking diet sodas or some type of sodas cause depression.
Mm.
And I was a tab drinker way back in the day. And so I've given, yeah, so I was like, I'm really dating myself. But I've given up sodas. It's been a good 25 years. And I gave up coffee for 10 years ago.
No, now stop it. Now you gotta stop talking now. You can't continue the interview any longer. You stop drinking coffee? I don't drink coffee, but that's some people. That's like, well, good for you. Good for you.
Yeah, so absolutely. Who are your top two influencers in life, and what lessons do they teach you?
Absolutely. I think there's two. I know you asked in life, but let me answer it in business first, and you can help me align this. But I think in business, I'd say, which is a big part of life, I look at Steve Harvey. I just like how he runs his show, how he has empathy for people. I watch him. I watch his clips. I just like the guy's style. Steve Harvey's one. Seth Godin is another. For those who may not know that name, a best-selling author of, 17 or more books, a marketer. I like his stage presence and his take on the world of marketing. Unique in what we hear today. He has a new book out, This is Marketing. So those are two in business. I think in life, you know, I just watch a lot of the men and women in my community, in my church community and other places. So not one person probably, but I think anybody who has character, who has honesty, that's somebody who kind of I look at and say, huh, you know what? I like how they're rolling. I like what they're doing. So it's probably a mashup of many different types of people for my personal life, as it were. But in business, Steve Harvey and Seth Godin, for sure.
It's interesting you mentioned Steve Harvey. Did you hear the interview that he did with Oprah on her masterclass?
I did not. I have to hear
that. Oh, my gosh. I love masterclass Oprah.
Wow.
But and Steve tells a story about, and I mentioned this before on the podcast, but it's an amazing story. And if you follow Steve, I'm sure you heard the story about how his teacher persuaded him. He got in trouble about saying he wanted to be on TV.
Yes.
Okay. So that story. And it's interesting you mentioned about Seth, because in 2019, we're doing kind of a rebranding of the podcast. And we are going to take one of our Wednesday episodes and talk to a thought leader, a CEO, or an innovative thinker. And so the last 2 years, the show has been focused on primarily Black entrepreneurs. But now we want to broaden our horizon, and it's about how do we elevate Black entrepreneurs. So this is like, what is amazing about this, Ramon, is this is the first time I've really mentioned this on the podcast. And so we are going to start interviewing thought leaders that these are, or CEOs. So there may be a Black CEO that is not necessarily an owner of the company, or maybe there is someone else from another ethnic group that is willing to be on the show that can give us tips and strategies. So one of the Wednesdays we will use for that innovative thinker is what I'm calling it.
Love it.
I reached out to Seth to ask him to be on the show, and he told me to hit him up next year. So
I love it. He's just launched a book. That could be why. I'm not sure, but he just launched a book, and I know he has his 2 or 3 courses. But if you need help, let me know. But he'd be a great interview for sure.
Yeah, if you have any push that way, please do. And I did reach out. Would love to have him on. Thank you for that. And I love both, like Steve Harvey. I think he's like the best dressed man in the world besides my husband. Had to throw that in.
Absolutely. I think he's one of the best dressed men in the world too, besides me. So I agree.
See, besides my husband and Ramon, and then it's Steve Harvey, right?
Absolutely.
Ramon, what is a technology tool or a technology platform that is a must-have for you in managing your business day-to-day?
Absolutely. I think task management is a must for me and my team. We cannot be on the same page if we're not. So task management is for sure. Definitely CRM, the word's so broad, customer relation management, but in essence, a shared database of clients. I think that's the second must. Of course, as I've alluded to, I live on email. Email's just, and it's not just the email service. Which one it is a dime a dozen. It's how you use it. So that's a third tool that I use quite a bit, email. And definitely my browser. We're all, of course, using a browser of some sort. But for me, I live online, as it were. So I have multiple computers, mobile and otherwise. To me, they're like razor blades. I could throw out my notebook computer today and be just fine because it's all backed up. It's all in the cloud. So I would only cry having to pay another $2,000 to get the one I want. So that's it.
On the CRM that you mentioned, is there a specific brand that you're using that's reasonable? I love Salesforce, but that was when I was working for a company. It's a little bit pricey. Do you have any recommendations for those that are starting out for a really good CRM system that's not that pricey like Salesforce?
Sure, absolutely. To your point on Salesforce, and I will mention that they were one I was going to mention. Salesforce, I think they have been pricier. That's been the thought behind them because many big companies use them. But they have a new package. It's called Salesforce Essentials, which is built for smaller businesses, much, much lower cost, different pricing than what people may think. So Salesforce, I'd give a nod to them for sure. Another one is Zoho, Z-O-H-O. Great software, great tool. And again, these tools, two of these competing products, as it were, operate differently. Salesforce is kind of the leader in the sales for startups and growing businesses. Zoho has 40 plus tools, many of them for free as you're starting out. But I think both can work. But Zoho, great support as the Salesforce. But that's what I would go to for business owners. Look at Zoho or a Salesforce.
You talked about you had an amazing wife. How do you include your family, your personal life, your family, and your business life with you doing a lot of speaking and traveling? How do you integrate your family into all of that?
Absolutely. And so I would say a few ways. I think, and again, life is in stages too. My kids are adult children now, no longer babies as it were. So of course the needs and what you're giving to them, what they're giving to you is going to be different than say when they're 3 years old. But over the years, if this helps, there's a few things. One, my family has been able to travel with me, not all the time, but from time to time with me on trips. So that's been kind of a perk that, you know, when I'm speaking, my kids can be in the room. I remember my son at the age of 4 years old was playing with Hot Wheel cars under the chairs in the back as I was on speaking at an event, I recall. So that's one tip maybe for those who have younger children. If it's helpful for some, you can integrate your family with you that way. That's one. Point two, listen, as an entrepreneur, one who has a working in his home office, you're either going to have your proverbial 9-to-5 job. I bet you're leaving your home at 7, getting back at 7 or 8, or later, you're out of the house maybe more than I am. So I have the flexibility to run my life the way I want. I can integrate, you know, my family into that life with the time flexibility. That's two. And three, I think is useful, is that I really educate my family in how I make my money and what I'm doing. I'm flying out and away for 2 days because this helps us live the life we want. Now, that doesn't mean it can be an excuse. I'm going to be away for a month. My wife wouldn't even have that. But my point being, if you educate family, hey, I'm going to be gone these 3 days, but I'll be home for 10 days. Huh? Okay. Please go away for 3 days then. You're going to be home for 10. So those are the three ways I would say kind of how I integrate, bring in my family life. My wife has helped me even. She has her own interest and ventures and things she does. But yeah, she's helped me at my conferences even. She's put stickers on bags and so has my kids. So we're not quite a family business, but they're very much a part of what I'm doing. And I'd like to think that I'm very much a part of what they're doing.
One of the biggest questions a lot of people would like to know when they're listening to the podcast is about capital and financing your business. And I know that you had talked about earlier on about being at the United Nations, and then that had kind of abruptly came to an end. How did you finance your business?
Sure. So three ways, three things I'll send out. One, how I financed the business now to enable me to live when I didn't have the UN income. I had saved up, and also I had a big contract. It so happened, thank you God for that, it so happened that I had a nice contract when I was leaving the UN. Whether I was cheating or not, in a good way, meaning I was kind of set up for at least a few months. I could, you know, wait it out, as it were, when I left. So that's about the United Nations. Financing business overall, for me, it's been two ways. One, credit cards. No shame about that. Listen, it's a fast way. If you need to get whatever you need to get, $10,000, $5,000, $25,000, credit cards can be great, but don't get in debt. Meaning, be careful that you can manage that debt as you're growing your business. Credit cards are good. Two, listen, Dr. Richards, I like to think I'm great at selling. I remember when I did one of my first conferences, Intuit, Makers of QuickBooks was one of the first sponsors at Intel. The conference call had like many of their executives on the line. I had never done it before, but I sold them on the idea and passion that I could do it. And I tear up every time I say this, and they believed in me. So sometimes that can be your financing. Can you sell the $50,000, $100,000 idea to get the cash in to go on? And then don't forget the traditional types of financing. You can get loans, lines of credit. I've used lines of credit before to launch some of my ventures, lines of credit. Borrow money from family and friends. Be careful about that. You want Aunt Granny to be nice and sweet for a long time, not to hate you. So family and friends. And then, of course, there's venture capital or angel funding, which is a whole different game, but it's doable. But I would tell many people, because I'm asked that, like somebody, a lady had emailed me, Ramon, you know, I need, for example, I want $10,000 from a venture capitalist to launch my laundromat, for example, making it up. I'd say be careful. Can you get money from anywhere else? Can you do Uber, do dishes, work two jobs? Startup financing is expensive, especially if you haven't launched it yet. There's no proven track record. So I try to do everything you can to own as much of your own business as you can, especially if you're not planning on being a multi-million-dollar, billion-dollar brand.
How do you keep your happiness throughout your journey?
Boy, sometimes I wonder. listen, I think my faith has a lot to do with it. And those who are listening, if faith is not your thing, whatever it is inside you that makes you go on beyond your purpose. But for me, it's definitely my faith. I think I like to think I'm well-grounded in that. Not that I haven't suffered with some nasty stuff. I've gone through a period of my life where I suffered with depression and suicide. If anybody just Googles my name, you can see my talk on that and other things. But depression and suicide I've gone through. So I haven't lived a perfect life, but I think it's my faith which grounds me. Family grounds me. You know, I refer back to my wife. Thank God for her, who she keeps family alive, as it were. That's what she enjoys. And me being in the family, I benefit from that. Having good friends around me who can smack me when I need to be smacked or lift me up when I need to be lifted up. So I think the combination of that and that's, I like to think to a degree, I'm an upbeat person. You know, if somebody spits on me, I'll assume, you know, they were trying to get a bug off my face or something. That's just me. I respond more happy to adversity before I assume it's negative, if that kind of weird example made sense.
And thanks for being transparent about dealing with your own depression and suicide. Talk about self-care and give us your tips and strategies for Ramon's self-care.
Absolutely. I think, and I no longer, again, thank God for that, no longer do I have issues with it at all in any way. But there's a period of my life where I was experiencing some low things. And I think the way I say to pull yourself out of that is, now, thankfully, it wasn't some deep, deep, deep thing. Maybe I wasn't on drugs or anything, which, you know, add all these issues. But I think really the entrepreneur, now, there's all these depression and things happen with all sectors, police officers, military people, single moms, married moms and dads, everybody goes through all this. For me, it was, I think, as I put it in the lens of the entrepreneurial depression. And I think the way out of that, what is your purpose? What excites you for what you're doing beyond the money? I asked a young man about this. Why are you doing what you're doing? What you're doing? He said, I don't know. I don't know. And I said, that's part of the struggle you're having. I know exactly why I'm doing what I'm doing. I want to create wealth so I can give it to other people. This is the only reason I exist. Meaning for my business, I want to take care of my family. But Dr. Richards, I hope one day I'm a multi-millionaire so I can give a check for $100,000 to somebody. I don't need to do $1.8 million like Mayor, you know, former Mayor Bloomberg did to, was it John Hopkins 2 days ago? I don't need to do that. But can I give $5,000 to a single dad who's struggling? Can I give $10,000 to build a new park? So my point is, what grounds me is I know why I'm doing what I'm doing, and that makes me so happy and excited. I have a smile when I wake up.
What is your biggest achievement so far in your business?
I've had a few, and I think what comes to mind really is, ironically, especially with this political time we're in, I've been honored to interview President Obama in his first live video chat a few years ago. So that was an honor to interview the president. And I tell people, you know, as I straddle both political realms, you never know what audience you're in front of. I hung out with Ivanka Trump in India a year or two ago. Mm-hmm. So that was cool to be able to be at the highest, I think the word is echelons of our government, Ivanka Trump and President Obama. That's been pretty cool. And I think, you know, being able to be on a few TV shows, which is cool. One of my goals, I'd love to have my own TV show one day or be a featured contributor. And the other thing I'll leave you with is just being on stage or around so many amazing people, hosting a Black Enterprise event a year, being on stage with Seth Godin, Simon Sinek, Damon John. So, you know, it's been an honor. I would say that what I just said, President Obama, Ivanka Trump, those have been some of my biggest, I think, accomplishments to date. And we have yet to see what else will happen.
And so in your crossing, if you run into President Obama again,
yes,
tell him that they must call my mom. She's 90 years old and she absolutely loves President Obama and she would love to meet him. So if you cross that path again, please have them call Bernice Pierce. She's on Facebook as Granny BP and she loves, loves, loves President Obama.
I love this. You know what? If he calls me, we will see if we can make that happen. His people will call my people. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, she loves him so much. So tell us a song title that would best describe you or your brand, Ramon.
High energy, high information.
Love
that's what
that.
We seek to do all the time. I happen to be a high energy person according to what my audience says, what my community says, but I really like to think I can dispense a lot of information. And what the sponsors and clients I work with, they say, Ramon, we love that you always have an answer, not just off the cuff like anything, but if it's about technology, marketing, and business, I can speak all day about it.
When you went to college, did you major in marketing or business?
I started out with engineering. Before that, I was doing electrical technology because, you know, the admissions council, you like tech, be an engineer. But who knows? That's why I tell young people it's always good to change. And by the way, a website for young people, 3traits.com. Some tips I have for young people. But I started with electrical engineering or ended up there. But yes, I ended with marketing. But Dr. Richards, as you may know, at least for me, the bachelor's, the first years of school, it wasn't what really gave me the foundation for marketing. It was making mistakes, screwing up, serving clients, spending my own money on failed things and saying, that didn't work too well.
Talk about your legacy. Ramon, when it's all said and done, how do you want to be remembered?
Yeah, I talk about that with my family. I think a few things. Two things. I think one, I would love for people to say that Ramon, and again, I hate to bring up my faith so much. I don't hate, but I respect. There's a lot of people listening, you know, who may have different faiths. But for me, Ramon was a man of God. I'd like, first and foremost, people to know that Ramon, he lived a life. He was fun. He was on Facebook and Twitter and doing all kind of cool things. But overall, he represented Christ. He represented God most of his life. So that's one. I think two, if I could be known beyond that, that I helped other people, it's all worth it. That when I die, and not, of course, my first allegiance to my kids and my family and my wife, but speaking overall in life, I want to go out being, as it were, being on all fours, and hundreds of people can stand on my back and propel themselves forward with my hand on my shoulders. That would make me, that's what I want, that I helped other people.
And let me say this to you, Ramon, you don't have to be apologizing for your Christianity. I'm a Christian too, and I do respect and honor you for saying that because we are in the time where people get offended, but I like to let my guests be who they are, and I like to be who I am. So I appreciate you being open and honest and being willing to share who you are. So we appreciate that. So if you conducted this interview, what is the one question that you would have asked yourself and answer that question?
Wow, that's a great question. I'd probably ask myself, a lot of things, but I'd ask myself probably something focused on one question you asked about happiness is why am I so happy? And my answer to that would probably be, I love life. And I think other thing I'd ask myself is, okay, and I'm not going to answer it. You have to ask it, I guess. I would ask myself, what are some of the times when the glass could have been half empty, but I refused to see it as half empty, and I saw it as half full. That's what I'd ask myself.
And you would? So how did you answer that?
Okay, so the answer is going to be the times last week. I slept in the airport. Most people would have thought that was the terriblest, bummiest time of your life. But you know what? It was a great experience. Just to sleep in the airport. I've never done it before. I thought it was so cool. And it so happened the next day, that experience, that story I had, helped in something else I needed to do. So that's the story. And that's why I like to see the glass half full. If I get bumped from, you know, the economy, premium economy class to the back of the seat by the bathroom, I bet you I'm going to sit next to some guy who is like rocking it and I'm going to learn from him. That's what I like about life.
Tell us one of the most vital, life-changing piece of advice that you could possibly share with us.
Yeah, I think a few things. But I think there's so much advice that we can get. And I think for me, it's really probably take the time to think. Because for me, that's such a difficult thing. But I think the people in my life, I can, again, the mentor who passed away since Mr. S. Chidambaranathan, he said, Ramon, and I mimic his accent in respect. Ramon, you need to think. You need to slow down and you need to think. He would always tell me that. And so I think it's helped me so much because if you can slow down and think, if you have the time to do that, some people don't have the time to do that, but if you can make the time, you'll have options. You can, you won't have to redo an email. You won't have to apologize so much. If before you, let me say, okay, you need to think first. So that's probably the biggest piece of advice is to think, think, think.
I'm going to backtrack because we have just a couple of more questions. But Ramon, you talked about your email. Is there a technology tool or something that you're using that you're deleting a lot of emails? Or how are you managing that down to zero?
Absolutely. And zero means some days it could be five, just a full disclosure, two or 10. But, you know, it's not. I've seen people's email box with hundreds. So, but really, it's because, A, I'm on it quickly. I don't let email build up. That's point one. Point two, maybe because I have to, I eat through email, meaning you never know what deal's coming in. Two. And three, I filter like crazy. If I don't have to respond to it today or in the next few hours, I immediately send the email to another folder. That folder I look at every Friday. It's called I forgot the name of the folder. I can look at it right now. It's called the catch-up folder, catch-up reading. And right now there's 168 emails in that folder, which is not a lot because on Friday, they'll all go down. So that's kind of my system. I filter automatically. Email newsletters, by the way, go to that same folder. And as I'm going along through the day, my finger is kind of like Tinder. Left, right, very quickly I filter. And another tip, if it helps, I use good subject lines. So let's say me and Dr. Richards are talking, and she changes the topic to pecan pie. But the first email was about speaking contracts. I'm going to change the subject line to pecan pie. So we can have two email threads, one on contracts, one on pecan pie, if that makes sense.
And you also have a team that you're working with, right?
Absolutely. And I say that, listen, a solo entrepreneurship is great. You can do that and live and it'll be what it is. Fine. And that's for some people, but you'll only grow to a certain level, which if that's for you, it's fine. Once you have a team, it sets you free. So I have a project manager / administrative assistant, and she is the backbone to a lot of things I'm doing, managing the world, the tasks of Ramon Ray. Then we have an agency, an individual who has a few people under her, and that's who helps us produce our content. I do a lot of design work for clients and for myself. I have one of the best designers in the world. And we have video editors. So that's the team we have, video, content, design, and managing projects with clients. And it's a pretty smooth ship.
And thank you for that, Ramon. I just wanted to be very clear to the audience if they were listening, because I've also been in that space and place where as a solo entrepreneur, and I wanted them to be clear that you had a team and that, you know, help was there. I remember reading a post and someone was saying, you know, we all have 24 hours. And then they were just showing your 24 hours versus Beyonce's 24 hours and all the people she had around her. So I just wanted us to be there. I like to be very transparent. And people are saying, well, how is he doing that? So thanks for that.
Absolutely.
Ramon, we come to the part of our interview. It's called Fun Facts Lightning Round. And I'm going to give you a series of questions and I'd like you to answer them very quickly. If there's something you desire not to answer, feel free to say pass. Are you ready for the Fun Facts Lightning Round?
I'm ready. Do I get like a car if I win? Do I get like a Steve Harvey show, a car, a vacation in Hawaii or something?
Yeah, what we're going to do is Steve Harvey is going to send you one of those television sets that he's sending to his teacher.
Love it.
Steve, are you listening? Right? The last movie you saw?
Mile 22.
You relaxed doing what?
Eating a warm pound cake with ice cream slightly warmed in the microwave.
Your favorite singer or rapper?
Favorite singer is probably, We Fall Down and We Get Up, Donnie McClurkin.
Your favorite dance song?
Don't have one.
What food do you eat every week, no matter what?
3 pancakes, burnt, and bacon.
Your favorite month?
December.
Ramon, thank you so much for joining us on Black Entrepreneur Experience Podcast. Before we conclude, can you share with our audience the best way that they can reach you and all of your social media handles and how they can support and do business with you?
Absolutely. Best way to reach me is through RamonRay.com, RamonRay, RamonRay.com. If I can serve and help any of you in the Black Enterprise and Beyond audience, you can just email me as well, Ramon, R-A-M-O-N, at smarthustle.com. And I'm on all the social platforms under that name. And best way to service, listen, help me, invite me out to your city to come and speak. But I'm here to serve and help and work with amazing people like Dr. Richards. So thank you.
Thank you, Ramon. That's a wrap.
Thank you for listening and subscribing to Black Entrepreneur Experience. We would love for you to leave a review and rating on iTunes and share with your friends. For show notes and more episodes, go to www.beepodcast.com. Join us next Wednesday, and remember, green is the new black. So keep your bank accounts and your business in the black.